a fantastic webinar in front of us today with speakers representing a broad regional divide as well as a broad topical divide. And this webinar is in cooperation between DIANOVA and WFAB. And this cooperation is something that we are very glad to have been working with since prior to the 2020 CND, so the United Nations Commission on the Narcotic Drugs, and during which we launched our joint infographic offering a way forward, which we will make available in the chat, and you're most welcome to use going forward. And when we had this infographic launch, we had a side event which was really well visited, and we learned so much. And what we also took away was that we need more webinars like this with a broad range of speakers and a broad range of topics. So that's why we're here today, and we hope that we'll be able to offer you similar events in the future that go more into depth in regards to the key themes that we're offering today. So before handing over to our moderator, I would just like to express my gratitude and thank you to our partners at DIANOVA, our interpreter, our colleagues handling the practicalities, of course, our speakers, and to you attendees who are with us today. I hope that you will enjoy this webinar. And Lucia, thank you for moderating this for us today. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Regina. Well, on behalf of DIANOVA, also welcome, and thank you very much for joining us. We were, as Regina said, we were keen to meet professionals working in different drug-related services to gather their expertise and to have a more holistic and integrated approach into the implementation of a gender perspective. And here we are. So I'm really glad to be moderating this, this event. Before starting, we would like to know a bit more about you, about the participants. And that's why we prepared the questions on Slido, a bit like an icebreaker, and also to know where you're coming from and what your main interest might be. So if you can go into Slido with the QR code that we have, or entering the website, you will see that there will be a question coming up. We are quite new to this, so bear with us, please. In here, you should be able to see the first question, and you can type in directly. That's good. Many different countries so far. Also different continents. Nice. You're getting to this, you're getting a good answer rate. I'm really happy about this. So I think we can certainly say that there are people from all around the world. It's not only a region in particular. We'll give a few more seconds. Nigeria. Great. Shall we move on to the next question? Should appear on your screen. This way we can see from which field you're coming from. A lot of prevention, treatment. Moving fast, this is really nice to see. Good, so we have representatives from all sectors. More on prevention and treatment, a bit more, but that's good, good to see. So maybe we can go to the next question to kick off the conversation. It's just in a few words, if you can, what do you think are the main gender barriers to access and remain in drug-related services? Well, stigma is getting bigger, funding. Of course, it's a bit challenging to just find a few words for this. Gender-based violence, gendered impact of punitive drug policy, education and access to those services, the role of women as caretakers, discrimination, lack of gender perspective, stigmatization, culture, religion, and policy, resources such as childcare, masculinization of services,
let me type in,
crime. Wow, lots of answers here. Clearly some of them appearing bigger, stigma, lack of gender perspective, funding. I'm pretty sure this will come up in today's webinar. But I think this is a very good start and really paves the way into this roundtable. So we'll keep the answers and we'll certainly be talking about that more and more. But let's get started if you want. We are honored to count with experts from different parts of the world and from different fields. And I would like to briefly introduce you before starting with the questions. So we have Diana Joseph with us from Managing Trustee of the Fourth Way Foundation, India, and she's coming from the field of prevention. She has over 15 years of experience at the grassroots level and advocacy level, and she also combines this with research work. She has a special focus on children with special needs. Secondly, we have Jorgelina de Iorio. She's the coordinator of the intervention area of Asociación Intercambios from Argentina, and she's working in the field of harm reduction. She has a PhD in psychology and is a professor and researcher interested in the intersection of mental health, social inequalities, and particularly among vulnerable populations. Third place, we have Edward Carlson. He's the chief executive officer of Odyssey House Louisiana in the USA, and he's working in the field of treatment. He has over 30 years of experience in the addiction field, and he has been responsible for over 39 treatment programs over his career, and currently serves as the president of the Treatment Communities of America. And here I would really like to thank Ed for being with us now, because with the time difference, it is either very late at night or very early in the morning for you. So this clearly shows your commitment. Thank you for being with us, Ed. And last but not least, I would like to welcome Jane Mangi, founder of Willing Way Wellness Center in Kenya, and she comes from the rehabilitation field. The organization she represents works both in treatment and rehabilitation, and she is also the executive director of Unheard Voices Africa, a community-based organization working with women, children, and youth. So now we will close the PowerPoint presentation so we can see our faces, and this really is more like a roundtable, more like a conversation. What I will do is I will pose one question to the four panelists, and I will give each of you 4 minutes to answer. And I'll be keeping track of time to make sure that we have time for the Q&A session later on. So let's get started. The first question that we would like to know is, what are the main barriers that women face to access and remain in your services? And what would you say are the most urgent aspects to be tackled from a gender perspective for including women, other gender identities, and LGBTQ plus persons? So I would like firstly to give the floor to Diana. I'm eager to listen to you. You're on mute.
Can you hear me now?
Great,
yeah. Can you hear me, Lucia?
Ed, I can't hear you.
You said yes.
Ed said you're listening to
Ed her? Said yes. Okay. Yeah, I hope the others can hear me as well. Regina, yes?
I can hear you now.
Yeah, now.
Okay. Fine. I am basically, I represent the country India. I'm speaking on behalf of the Asian perspective, mostly when I'm addressing this. And the others on the panel can actually pitch in to whatever dimensions I might not be able to cover when we speak about specific barriers. Just to give a little brief into the kind of barriers women face out here in the Asian perspective, like elsewhere in the world, is that we all enjoy different social statuses in different communities. Because of our economic, social, cultural differences, women are given different status quo. So is the status quo for a girl child, which is a young adolescent, sometimes a wife and spouse, or somebody who is a mother. They are all different in terms of the kind of status or the space we enjoy in our communities. That itself, I suppose, is one of the biggest barriers to access for treatment for women. Because there is no one size fits all when it comes to saying, okay, there is a treatment protocol, there is a treatment access format. And that sort of hinders women in the perspectives of rights. They don't realize their rights in terms of seeking treatment or care or even understanding a right to say no. Because most of the cases that we see are women who are with partners who have a substance abuse problem and are forced into the substance abuse issue. So mostly they don't even know that they have a right to say no within the marriage or within the household or within the community sometimes. So one of the biggest barriers that we see is that women really don't know their rights. They don't believe that they can stand up and say no in certain circumstances or demand for their treatment and care programs. So that's one big overarching issue when women issues are concerned around substance abuse. The other that we see clearly is a stigma that is attached to women using substances or in the problem or who are affected by it as well. So there are a bunch of women who are affected by the problem because somebody in the household is using it. And there are a set of related problems that they need to deal as women of the household who are affected. But then the women who are addicted or who are in the problem of having some kind of dependency have another total different stigma attached to coming out, accepting they have a problem, seeking help, seeking treatment. So these two are our biggest socio-cultural specific issues when it comes to women seeking services or access to treatment and care. With all the other gender perspective issues, I think one of the largest that we see prevalent in our community is that there is no gender-specific treatment care for women. It's always within the setup of a de-addiction program for adults where men are being treated, and there are no very specific gender treatment protocols as well. So these are our large issues around it. I'll pass on to the next speaker, and if there's anything else.
Thank you very much, Diane. So I'd like now to ask Jorgelina, what are the main gender barriers in harm reduction services?
Bueno, primero contarles que hablo desde Argentina, desde Buenos Aires, y en América Latina y el Caribe tenemos aproximadamente 5.5 millones de personas que usan drogas, y uno de los primeros problemas o barreras que tenemos es no saber exactamente cuántas son las mujeres o personas pertenecientes a comunidades LGTBIQ+, que consumen drogas, y precisamente esto se debe a una de las barreras que ustedes mencionaron en la primera ronda, que es la persistencia de los estigmas, ¿no? En el caso de las mujeres y las comunidades LGTBIQ, la dificultad de expresar sus consumos por el temor al rechazo, a la violencia, a ser criminalizadas o penalizadas. En América Latina y el Caribe persisten los paradigmas punitivos y lo que llamamos la guerra contra las drogas, que ha generado mayores problemas a las mujeres que usan drogas en las comunidades LGTBIQ, que incluso el propio efecto de las sustancias, ¿no? Por además el no responder a los estereotipos de género patriarcales que vulneran las posibilidades de toma de decisiones más libres en las mujeres particularmente y en las comunidades con otras elecciones diversas de identidades de género. ¿No? Esa doble estigmatización, justamente por no solamente ser usuarias de drogas, sino por no responder a ese estereotipo de mujeres cuidadoras o ser vistas como malas madres, fracasadas, ¿no? En esta multiplicidad de estigmas o de valoraciones negativas que portan que claramente se hace mucho más severo o con mayor gravedad en el caso de las mujeres embarazadas o aquellas que, personas gestantes y además aquellas que tienen hijos ¿no? o están a cargo de la crianza. Un segundo, digamos, barrera o dificultad, por lo menos en el campo, ¿no? de la reducción de riesgos y años, tiene que ver con el no reconocimiento de las identidades de género, pese a que en nuestro país, particularmente, que ha sido pionero en la región en pensar las legislaciones inclusivas hacia el reconocimiento de las identidades de género y los derechos de las personas trans, travestis y otras elecciones no binarias, persisten, ¿no? miradas de los trabajadores de la salud y de otros sectores que acompañan problemas vinculados con los usos de drogas, y cuando estoy hablando de programas de reducción de daños, no se limitan específicamente a aquellos servicios que asisten a personas que puedan estar teniendo un problema vinculado con el consumo, sino a un amplio aspecto de vulnerabilidades que hacen a la vida de las personas en la región, ¿no? Digo, violencias estructurales, como también mencionaba Diana. Entonces, en esos servicios persiste todavía, ¿no? Incluso a veces en servicios vinculados con la reducción de riesgos y años, el no reconocimiento de la identidad de género. Y ahí me gustaría citar brevemente, creo que todavía estoy en tiempo, sino a una mujer trans de Jujuy. Jujuy es una provincia en el norte de nuestro país, que en un reciente estudio que hicimos desde intercambios, ella dice: hay médicos que no saben ni cómo llamarme. Yo estoy en la punta del servicio y ponen mi nombre como varón. Yo me levanto, todos me miran y ahí soy motivo de burla, ¿no? Digo, como ese no reconocimiento de la identidad. Y dos más, brevemente, el no reconocimiento de la diferencia de los patrones de género, ¿no? La falta de información sobre los modos en que los consumos se expresan en los distintos grupos de mujeres y colectivos LGTBIQ, ¿no? Ni que hablar de la diferencia entre consumos desde la perspectiva más binaria de mujeres y varones, pero después entre las mujeres, entre las personas con identidades sexuales diversas, barreras vinculadas a la edad, ¿no? En el caso de las niñas y adolescentes, se considera que además por ser menores de edad, pese a que hay legislaciones en la región que permiten el acceso a los servicios, sigue persistiendo. Y finalmente, lo último y más importante, que es que en Argentina, ¿no? en el Cari, en esta región, la vinculación con las cadenas de tráfico, las mujeres son las que más participan en los pequeños eslabones como modo de subsistencia económica, y eso muchas veces no se contempla para pensar cómo eso se expresa en el acceso a un servicio. Perdón si me demoré.
Thank you so much, Jorgelina. Now I would like to ask Ed, what do we absolutely need to tackle for increasing women and other gender identities and LGBTQ plus people in treatment centers?
Thank you. So I think one of the key elements here is around educating the treatment centers as well as the people who are providing services. I think it was just mentioned that the lack of understanding about being sensitive to gender-related issues really seems like a core essence of what has to happen. I know within our organization, we really focus on the idea of educating our staff, everyone from the person who comes up at the front desk to the person who provides services, our medical personnel, et cetera, about how to be sensitive to gender-related issues. Specifically for women, I think that women and people from the LGBTQ community wind up suffering a lot more trauma associated with addiction. And so we have a curriculum that we have been using called Seeking Safety that helps with the idea of focusing on trauma and trauma-related issues. And one of the things that we did in reorganizing our treatment system was to sort of divide out and allow opportunity for gender-specific focus. So that that way for treatment and for treatment service. So we have gender-specific groups that give people the opportunity and that are run by people who have a good understanding of the gender-related issues, specifically for women, women with trauma, people from the LGBTQ community who are suffering from a lot of trauma, shame, or stigma associated with the services that they need. So one of the core essence we find is this idea of education and getting people to sort of make everything seem a lot more normal in the process. So when somebody comes in, we're not like, oh my God, you know, it's a trans woman. And so we need to do something. Everyone doesn't even notice that at this point. We just sort of bring them in. We accept them for who they are. They get to make the decisions about where they want to go within our treatment system. And then we make them feel comfortable. We do the same thing by educating the clients as they come in so that they understand that that's an important component because they need to understand everybody's here for treatment. And that's where we're all coming from. And they need to let go of some of their preconceived thoughts about anything from gender, race, sexual identity, the whole nine yards. So we really focus on this idea of trying to educate. I'm very happy that for once my government, the United States, they actually have seen this as a particular issue. And the curriculum that was developed was from a grant that we received from the federal government specifically on this issue to help us to create our program to be much more gender specific and gender, be able to provide gender specific treatment services. And especially addressing the issues of trauma and trauma related to their addiction or their lives that they have experienced. I hope that answers your questions.
Thank you so much for sharing this very valuable experience with us. I would like now to pose the question for Jane is how does it look like in the field of rehabilitation in Kenya?
Thank you. In Kenya, just as my colleagues have shared, we have the aspect of stigma more so. Being a third world country, the cultural barriers are just too much for women. So you find most women will not really want to come out for treatment because they will start being judged, you know, in quotes by the society. Also, we don't really have designed programs where we'd say it's a women only kind of rehabilitation where they go to. So you find there's a lot of invisibility with the women coming out to go for treatment. Also, they look at the family, you know, they're not allowed, decision making is not really, they don't get that leeway of making a decision of really what they want to do or whether they want to go for treatment. So you find in most cases they will suffer because from a cultural perspective, let's say from a gender even perspective, as a lady, even if you're married and you're going through turmoils, you're not supposed to bring it out to the family because you're supposed to conform to the norms and the culture. So that is really part of the challenges we face. As per se, we don't really have a program, would say it's designed specifically for women. And you find we don't even have many centers. Actually, it's just a few months I've seen now in one of the groups we are in saying that we have a female rehab only. In most cases, you find they are mixed rehabilitation centers and privately sponsored. So you find the aspect of even paying for that treatment becomes a challenge. So for the part of the other question of LGBT, that is a very thorny area from Kenya, because legally, actually, we are still fighting from a civil society perspective on their rights. I mean, no one needs to be discriminated to have rights, but it's something which is still ongoing. So it's you can't come out like the way Edward had said. You know, even the federal government is supporting some of those programs. As for us, not yet, but we are hoping as we proceed in the future, something is going to happen. So it becomes very, very hard for that now special population also coming out and speaking out on what they are going through, mostly from a substance abuse aspect. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So it's important to be aware of those things, to tackle it, as you said, in an integrated manner. Certain things such as stigma, lack of information, being it on rights or on the number of consumptions or on the patterns of consumption, the point that Ed really pointed out about the education of the professionals, non-recognition of gender identities, very good notes. Thank you very much for this. So moving on to the next questions. Here, I would like to ask for those concrete measures that would improve women's engagement in your services. If you can give specific examples, that would be great. Thank you very much. Let's start with Diana.
There are certain issues that lead to the issues of women not seeking support. And those, I list that out and sort of then move on to the measures that we could work on. So there is a clear fact that women are underrepresented because there is no evidence or data to back it up. Not that there are no women who have a problem with addiction or don't seek help. It's just that there is an underrepresentation across from the policymaking to the funding that's been allotted to the care programs that's been sanctioned by the government or civil societies who work on it. There's an underrepresentation of the gender aspect. That itself becomes one of our biggest issues to lead to concrete measures to work on women programs. So there is a need for us to work on bringing some evidence to the table in terms of data, some kind of numbers that actually validate the fact that there are enough women as equal as men or even more in many cases in many societies that need treatment and care and need to come out and accept that they have a problem. So the huge issue is the underrepresentation issue of women across the board. Then there is a serious fact about women delaying in seeking help. That when compared to men is a very concrete factor. They sort of, like the previous speaker just mentioned, a lot of socio-cultural issues keep them from accepting they have a problem. More or less men in the household decide if they even need treatment or care or things like that. So there is a steady delay in women coming out and accepting that they need to really seek support. So there the measures, I suppose, is a lot of, like I previously mentioned, a little more rights-based, that women have an equal call for dignity and status, and they can seek for their right, and they have the opportunities to come out and seek help. So that is one of the measures that we could take. The other is also about not being able to decide for the household. So if they really are the mothers of the household or people who really take care of your other siblings or members in the family, they are not able to make that decision to go in for treatment and care because there are a lot of dependents around them. So there needs to be some concrete measures in addressing that support system. If she's the center or whoever we're speaking about is the center of the household and they need to step out for care, there are X number of people who are dependent on that person. For a support system for care and program is a very important measure that we need to look at when we look at women seeking help, women coming out and accepting that they have a problem. And then there is also the largest issue of trauma. There are various reasons why women seek solace in substance or get into the habit of being dependent on substances. Studies prove that it's primarily based on some kind of a trauma that they've been through, something in life that's leading them to seek that, or somebody is influencing them. So that core issue has to be addressed in the treatment protocol. While we work with women, there is a aspect of wanting to address the trauma issues that lead them or keep them dependent. So of the four issues that I've mentioned, the concrete measures definitely revolve around providing that space for women to come out and accept and say they need help, providing support systems that enable them to be in the program while people dependent on them have care and support. And last of all, the trauma bit. So this is my little summary on this question in particular.
Thank you very much. Just a technical aspect to make sure that all the panelists are in their English or Spanish channels. Just please verify that. Thank you very much. So, Jorgelina, have you any concrete examples? Could you provide us any concrete examples from the field of harm reduction?
Sí. Por un lado, distinguir que desde la perspectiva de reducción de riesgos y daños identificamos o generamos, se generan acciones a nivel individual o singular, o sea, de cómo las mujeres y las comunidades LGTBIQ pueden acceder a acciones que hacen al nivel de lo colectivo y de lo grupal, ¿no? Más a las normas grupales, a las estrategias colectivas y también acciones en el campo de lo sociocultural o de la incidencia política, que es una línea de trabajo muy fuerte en los programas de reducción de riesgos y daños, sobre todo porque pretenden cambiar las miradas y los patrones estigmatizantes hacia las personas que usan drogas y en particular hacia las mujeres. Entonces, en el campo quizás de las acciones en el plano de lo singular, hemos generado, vinculado quizás con lo que también planteaba él, los programas en los que trabajamos con adolescentes y jóvenes en el contexto de comunidades vulnerables, y también en programas que se desarrollan en contextos de consumos recreativos, ¿no? Vinculados a las violencias sexuales asociadas con los consumos, que esos puntos de encuentro, esos espacios donde las personas pueden ir a buscar información y que funcionan en dos comunidades en particular, se transformen en un punto amigable y accesible para que las mujeres y las comunidades puedan denunciar acciones de violencia, ¿no? Que se sientan confiadas, ¿no? En que es un lugar amigable en el que pueden plantear alguna acción y además brindar orientación hacia los programas específicos que deben asistir a, en el caso de que hubiera una denuncia o una situación de no acceso a derechos por ser mujeres, ¿no? Y estar con una situación asociada a los problemas de uso de drogas. Digo, porque es fundamental articular, ¿no? Y articulamos con los programas gubernamentales o con otras organizaciones que asisten, ¿no? Los programas de reducción de riesgos y daños son un primer umbral en el acceso a la asistencia o a los servicios. Una segunda que me parece importante mencionar, que tiene que ver con la dimensión más colectiva o grupal, tiene que ver con los sistemas de apoyo, un poco lo decía Diana, y un programa que se está implementando, no directamente en intercambios, pero sí en asociación con el Ministerio de Géneros de la Provincia de Buenos Aires, en Argentina, que es un programa de mujeres efectoras comunitarias. Entonces, son mujeres que promueven solidaridad con otras mujeres, no necesariamente mujeres que sean usuarias de drogas o que estén atravesando un problema con el consumo, y justamente eso reduce los estigmas porque promueve solidaridad entre mujeres, pero son mujeres que están en acceso con otras mujeres, que pueden registrar vulneraciones de derechos, necesidades de asistencia o de tratamiento, y que nuevamente conectan con los servicios. Me parece que ese... ¿no? Las estrategias y los programas que conectan, ¿no? Justamente porque parte del problema es la no conexión con los servicios. Obviamente también generar investigaciones, hemos generado investigaciones específicas sobre algunas comunidades, podemos compartir después esos materiales, ¿no? Informaciones sobre patrones de consumo con personas trans, patrones de consumo en mujeres embarazadas, producir información ¿no? Más certera también reduce parte, y son parte de las estrategias. Y en el campo de lo que serían las campañas, más en el advocacy o la incidencia política, hemos generado incluso campañas en articulación con trabajadoras sexuales, con comunidades trans y con otras comunidades, sobre todo en la reducción del estigma, ¿no? Algo que quizás es un término muy local, pero que tiene que ver con el derecho de ir de gira y de volver de la gira, ¿no? Sobre todo la gira es la posibilidad de salir de fiesta, de ¿no? lo recreativo, no necesariamente todos los consumos tienen que ver con situaciones que requieran tratamiento, incluso aunque lo requieran, eso no justifica acciones de violencia sexual hacia las mujeres o comunidades LGTBIQ, entonces estamos trabajando mucho en el diseño de campañas de sensibilización con poblaciones claves. Muchos de esos materiales están disponibles, porque justamente parte también de la estrategia es que circulen y que otros los usen, ¿no? O los adapten en sus comunidades locales.
Thank you so much for sharing this very interesting practices that you're taking into account at the grassroots level, but also at the advocacy level. Thank you, Jorgelina. I would now like to ask Ed for if there are other concrete measures, or if you can also maybe enlarge a bit more on the seeking treatment program that you mentioned before, Ed.
Sure. Seeking safety was the name of the curriculum. That's okay. No problem at all. So the key element, I think, is first of all, just embracing the concepts and the ideas within your organization of treatment, and then allocating out the time necessary to separate out the genders so that way they can have treatment that's very focused and specific for them. So we do a lot of that at Odyssey House, where we do the gender-specific components and give them the opportunity to delve into issues that are more specifically related to their process and their recovery. And for women in particular, as I mentioned earlier, was around trauma and the need to address trauma-related issues for them. It is very interesting. We find that women in particular often play down or are in denial about the amount of trauma that they've experienced, specifically related to their addiction. I had just recently had listened to a woman who had experienced multiple rapes, and she was sort of justifying it from the other person's perspective. And we had to kind of pull her around to understand that was not the case for her, that she needed to understand about the trauma that was associated with that. And quite often, I think a lot of times that women they justify it in their mind as somehow they're the fault, they're the problem. And so what we have to do is to help them understand that that's not the case. And a lot of the things that they experience, yes, they are responsible for their addiction. They are responsible for having to deal with their addiction. But the issue related to it is that a lot of the trauma that they experience was something that was not necessarily their fault. And so our idea of sort of embracing and working closely with them, giving them the opportunity, and our counselors, they're beautiful and absolutely amazing to help sort of move them so they could be able to accept and understand these particular issues. And I think the Seeking Safety curriculum really helps a lot with that facilitation and that process.
Thank you so much, Ed.
Thank you.
I just want also to encourage participants to keep sending questions on Slido or through the chat. We will have time allocated for those, so don't be shy and go for that. So now I would move on to Jane and ask what could be done for overcoming the gender barriers. What is your experience?
Thank you. First and foremost is to encourage the women to be able to speak up, and also to educate them on the aspect of gender-based violence. Because most of what I picked, you find like women will go into depression because what they are going through, and that will lead one thing to the other. So having worked with a few ladies, that's what Ball actually, they unheard voices, because we realized most women are not able to speak up. And we thought maybe by coming up with that group from a community-based perspective, we'll be able to educate more women in the community. And we have gone a step ahead to work. We have counties. For me, I'm in a different county. So to come up with a gender office, we have come up with a program whereby we are going to have volunteers who have done addiction, or counselors who we can have on call, and where women are having problems or are going through and they are not able to come out for treatment, we see what can we do from an outpatient perspective before it gets to another level. So that is where we are. And also, you have come up with activities, small activities now from a community perspective, how we engage and get to educate the community to understand. Because like I said earlier, our cultural barriers really put women into a lot of stigma sometimes, the trauma, they're not able to come out. So we want to educate them to see that, speaking out and saying, I'm going through something and I need help, it's not really a big deal. So that's where we are. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So on the concrete measures, some of the things I could grab is certainly bringing the evidence and empowering women. I think that's also some of the things that you've been evolving around at, and promoting those safe places for women and also educating community. Thank you very much for this. I would like now to move on to analyze what would be the main difficulties for implementing actually gender sensitive programs at the operational level. Like, would it be, as referred earlier, a lack of professional training or a lack of spaces in the facilities, or is it funding? So what would be the main difficulty for implementing it? And what strategies have you implemented in your programs to overcome those? So Diana?
Thank you, thank you. In the prevention space, which is where I primarily work, it's important to understand that it's an extremely important factor when it comes to women and substance abuse, because there is a general trend or pattern where women take to substance quickly and they escalate quickly, and to come out of it, it's very difficult. So there is a huge prevention angle that supports women to keep away from this. And prevention activities are not well designed or not in any kind of an intervention component when it comes to substance programs, substance abuse programs. So prevention is to be given a primary space, because keeping women away or trying to keep the communities that are vulnerable, specifically children with disabilities, women with disabilities who have HIV, people who have various socioeconomic difficulties in actually accessing any kind of treatment, to keep them away in the prevention perspective really helps them to understand the benefits of having that kind of a format in the prevention exercise. What we do at our foundation and where we work is to engage early on. So we speak about early intervention as young as 12 years, young adolescents, where we've managed to do prevention programs that bring out young girls from their cocoons, where there's a social stigma, there's a social status quo. They understand that they don't have a space, and they very, very clearly know that they don't have a social space for communication, for education, for employment opportunities, and further into any kind of a full-fledged career. So starting early on, speaking to youngsters about the need for prevention, and that kind of a model in implementation sort of has helped us a lot. We also work on trying to teach youngsters early on about the rights for women, the CEDAW, CEWA. So that sort of also puts in perspective their right to food, the access to food, access to nutrition, access to treatment and care. All of that is not an understanding at all for young women here. So all of this in the prevention perspective plays a very important role for us to enable or implement gender-sensitive programs. And what we've also understood is that there is an effort to destigmatize all of this, but that gets into normalizing the use of drugs and substances. So there are a lot of measures that the government takes, which is not very evidence-backed, social media messages that go around, which sort of has an effort to destigmatize this among women and women users or LGBTQ users, but sort of gets to the point of normalizing the use of drugs. So there's a fine line that we need to draw, make clear what is destigmatization versus social normalization of the use of drugs. So for youngsters, they don't see that as an effort to make this this fine difference, or get to understand what it is. Same thing with mental health and dependency. We have increasing cases of opioid dependency here. I think when India as a continent, our country is looked at, we are looking at mapping human resources or people with large continents, which means we are one of those nations which will get onto opioid addiction very quick and very easy when large numbers. So while we speak mental health, there is a tendency for also kind of not speaking about dependency. So these are our big issues. What we've done is to start early. Early intervention helps, working on the rights of women helps, speaking about CEDAW is a big support for us to standardize some kind of a prevention effort. We're also looking at important factors there, women kind of who have started on or have some issues of drug dependency do not escalate. I know that that kind of a prevention intervention is also taking a big, strong grassroots presence right now. So they are initiated into drugs, but we take care not that, that they don't escalate and land into treatment centers quick. So these are a few measures we've taken, but we really lack the support from the government or agencies that really need to do it at scale. Who need to take it into large centers of treatment and care. So scale is a big problem in a country like mine, where we're talking about huge numbers and there's no social security or any other support system that can standardize these intervention programs.
Thank you so much, Diana. I would like now to ask Jorgelina, how does it look like in the harm reduction field, like for the programs you mentioned or other ones? What are the main difficulties and how are you tackling those?
Yo creo que la primera y central es que no hay financiamiento. Primero que en la región no existen programas de reducción de riesgos y daños que sean parte de las políticas públicas. Digo, es la sociedad civil la que ha generado y sigue generando a lo largo de la región los programas y que en los últimos años han perdido además financiamiento, con lo cual la falta de financiamiento y el no ser considerados como parte de una política pública sanitaria, digo, ¿no? La reducción de riesgos y daños es una política pública de salud, eso es una, me parece, de las principales dificultades, con lo cual parte de las acciones tiene que ver con el mantenimiento de una sociedad civil organizada, que esté en conjunto, que piense en los problemas de la región, pero también, ¿no? Y el trabajo en colaboración. Pero además, en el contexto de la pandemia, ¿no? Hemos registrado a lo largo de la región el cierre de algunos programas que podían tener financiamiento, con lo cual eso es parte, ¿no? Me parece que es central de las mayores dificultades para tener, ¿no? Porque además los recursos, obviamente, en países de la región, que están en contexto de mayor vulnerabilidad y de mayor pobreza, con indicadores ¿no? socioeconómicos más desfavorables, los financiamientos se desviaron o se desplazaron hacia dar respuesta, obviamente entendible, a los efectos de la pandemia del COVID-19, con lo cual eso es parte del problema. Y un segundo, para no repetir lo de la falta de datos, que me parece que Diana lo mencionó mucho y parece que insiste, ¿no? Digo, el no tener información y el basarlo en el diseño de programas basado en los prejuicios, pero lo conectaría con parte de lo que nosotros hemos registrado a lo largo de los 25 años que viene trabajando intercambios en la región sobre la necesidad de problematizar las representaciones sociales que los trabajadores de la salud y otros efectores que acompañan a mujeres y a comunidades LGTBIQ que puedan que usen o que tengan problemas vinculados con el consumo, tienen no solo sobre esas mujeres, sino también sobre el uso de drogas y sobre los tipos de tratamiento o de respuesta que son necesarios. Persisten miradas punitivas, normalizantes, ¿no? que pretenden organizar las respuestas de un modo universal, hegemónico y único, como si todos los problemas asociados con el consumo fueran iguales, incluso solamente centrados en problemas vinculados con la salud física, con la salud mental, sin desconocer que son parte de los problemas vinculados con los consumos, pero desde las perspectivas de reducción de riesgos y daños también identificamos problemas que tienen que ver con lo legal, específicamente la criminalización y la penalización de las mujeres que usan drogas. En la región encontramos un número muy alto de mujeres encarceladas por vinculado con menores eslabones de la cadena del tráfico como estrategia, con lo cual eso necesitamos, ¿no? Pensar estrategias diferentes y transformar esas representaciones sociales. Y además, sobre, como decíamos antes, no solo sobre los usos de drogas, sobre el modo de tratamiento o el tipo de respuesta, sino también sobre las identidades de género, ¿no? Digo, Me parece que persisten o identificamos incluso en esos relatos de personas que usan drogas, en los distintos relevamientos que fuimos haciendo, en los programas de intervención que desarrollamos en la comunidad, cómo persiste una mirada de que cierta práctica se traduce literalmente en necesitar un tratamiento o en tener una adicción, en juzgar las prácticas, sobre todo las prácticas sexuales de ciertos colectivos y comunidades, en particular de las trabajadoras sexuales, de personas con elecciones sexuales diversas. Y en ese encuentro con el profesional, ¿no? cuando los usuarios, las usuarias comentan sus prácticas, se deslizan esos prejuicios. Y eso es necesario de construir, ¿no? Generar programas de problematizar nuestras propias ideas, ¿no? Para la reducción de riesgos y daños, el trabajo con personas que usan drogas es también un trabajo con uno mismo y con los equipos que trabajan, más allá de que no estén atravesando un problema vinculado con el consumo.
Thank you so much. Very important points you raised. I would like now to ask Ed, what is your experience in implementing gender perspective into treatment? What do we need to take into account? What have you done?
So I think one of the things that's really important to notice, I actually find that, you know, what is sort of the difficulties? I think part of the difficulties is a lot of men in particular. I think that they tend to look at treatment from a male perspective, and they seem to sort of want to push it all on everybody else. I think that's sort of one of our main difficult barriers, unfortunately, is people of my gender. I think that we need to focus on, they need to be much more open and understanding that everything doesn't come from a male perspective. We have to engage and work closely with women and women in need and sort of start looking at things from their perspective. I think it's also important in a lot of the gender specific treatment, you know, people from women or from the LGBTQ community, that you actually employ and have people from those communities, as well as women who could work with other women. I think that a special male could be able to do it, but I think we're far and few in between. I think we need to have a lot more gender-specific treatment, and women need to be in the presence of other women to help deal with the issues that are associated with it. I think that that's a very, very important. I also think it's also a matter of resources and access to resources. I just want to make a mention that the curriculum for Seeking Safety is free and you can download it. There's a link. And Lucia, I did share the link with you. I don't know if you could share that maybe in the chat because anyone can download that information for free. It was developed by the government, which means anyone can have access to it. So I think that that's a good thing to have information, because information can be very helpful, and the access to information. And sometimes funding seems to be a bit of a barrier. It's a barrier for all of us in all of our fields. But sometimes if you have things that are accessible for free that you can access, it gives you an opportunity. I think one of the nice things about this curriculum, it also talks about how to implement it in a very positive fashion within the program. So I think part of the strategies has to be about being open and inclusive, disallowing the stigma associated with it, start being accepting people for where they are, and to also make sure that you're providing services to people who are representative of the gender and the group that you're working with.
Thanks so much, and thank you so much for sharing the information. Presita has already put it on the chat box. You can access it from there. Thank you so much, Ed. So I just acknowledge that we keep receiving questions, and we'll get to those. Just bear with me one more question to the whole panel, and we'll get there. Finally, Jane, what difficulties do you identify, and how do you overcome this from the rehabilitation side?
First is having, well-trained staff who can actually be able to deal with women issues and who understand, and also a well-tailored program whereby the women will be mostly involved in working the program, because you find most of the staff we have and in most of the organizations is usually male. So you find there's a bit of lack of communication, because if it's a woman who is going through treatment, sometimes opening up 100% becomes a problem. And two, also not having enough data just to know exactly what numbers are we dealing with, which whereby now we're looking at to carry out maybe an assessment and a research just to see exactly who are we dealing with and how many people, how do we get out to the community and help them from there. And the most challenging one is really, and you know, treatment, accessing treatment can be really expensive. So how are we going to make it affordable and so that more women can really be able to reach out for treatment?
Thank you so much. And now I would like to move on to the last question from our side, then we'll go to the Q&A questions. And is that, taking into account all these aspects, what would be your main request to the authorities? What kind of support do you need to effectively implement gender perspective in your services, Diana?
We have something that we have, we circulate as some kind of a prevention information to communities. So we sort of call it the prevention pyramid, where if we were to put the community, a general community, into the pyramid of use or taking to dependency on drugs, it's 5% right on top who really need care, support, treatment, de-addiction programs. Then there is a midsection of 10 to 15% of the population that really needs long-term care, counseling, long-term programs of support and care. While there is a majority of 70, 75% to 80% of people who are, what we say, sitting on the fence, they could fall either ways. And that's an important important chunk of the community that we need to keep safe and prevent them from falling into the category that needs long-term care, and also the category that's going into full-time de-addiction and support programs. Why I'm saying this is because but if you were to take patients like ours in Asia, the numbers that we're talking about, we cannot have that many kind of treatment and program care centers at all. The kind of program care, social security doesn't exist in the first place. And it will take us a decade or so to get there in terms of these facilities. So we need to have clear prevention strategies that really show people, youngsters, children, that there is no great merit in taking to drugs and going the cycle and struggling to regain their lives back. So our prevention strategy programs, as far as implementation is concerned, and what we would like the government to look at, is to consider early intervention right from the age of 12, because our age group is going further down. We have children as young as 6, 7, 8 years old coming in for care, counseling, treatment, and program. And that's scary, because right now the prevalence is 8 to 10%. And with COVID, just in the last 1 year of the COVID year, we have our numbers doubling to 24%. As prevalence, and that's really not healthy. And coupled with mental health issues, depression, children not being able to go out, women not being able to handle their homes, these numbers are just multiplying. And systemically, we are not ready to cope with any of these crises alongside the crisis of COVID. You've been hearing about India and our issues right here. So what we really need is a government that will proactively think through prevention strategies early, through early intervention programs, seriously invest in civil societies who are working alongside to make this easy on the communities. Look at trained professional as a first line of defense when it comes to keeping children safe, youth and young adults safe, and women safe in the community, LGBT communities who really can't come out and claim or share their stories. We have a very, very restrictive community that does not allow them to share their stories or come out in the open. And for that, we really need systemic efforts by the government to invest in programs that make it easy for them to accept that they have a problem, come out and seek help if they really need it, and provide personnel, train people, sensitize people who can really take them the full cycle of care program and treatment, more or less. So it's large. These issues are so immense, so large, so deep and intricate and layered. It will just take us a whole day to discuss it. But yeah, this is the much.
Perfect, large, but much needed. Thank you so much. So Jorgelina, what would be your main asks?
Fundamentalmente la modificación de las leyes punitivas que regulan no solo el control de la oferta, sino también el control de la demanda para las personas que usan drogas. Los enfoques punitivos en América Latina están siendo parte de los mayores problemas que genera en particular a las mujeres y a las comunidades LGTBIQ, y por eso desde Intercambios activamente somos parte de una campaña de acción global que se está desarrollando ahora en este mes, que es la campaña Support Don't Punish. Yo voy a poner el link en el chat, que en Argentina particularmente la venimos liderando hace varios años, pero que supone una discusión y una sensibilización hacia las comunidades, para la sociedad civil, interpelando a los decisores políticos, los altos niveles de decisores políticos, en la modificación de las políticas de drogas. En Argentina tenemos todavía una ley que penaliza y criminaliza ciertos comportamientos, y eso está generando una de las mayores barreras de acceso. Entonces necesitamos transformarlo, porque además eso coincide con otras leyes que pretenden facilitar el acceso a los servicios. Esa contradicción está haciendo mucho, mucho daño, ¿no? Y barrera en la posibilidad de acceder. Pero además en la región, para no pensarlo solo en la situación en Argentina, esos enfoques punitivos, la llamada guerra contra las drogas, se expresan en mayor militarización de las comunidades y de los territorios, mayor persecución policial hacia las comunidades más vulnerables y más empobrecidas, y mayor respuesta punitiva, represiva, en particular hacia las juventudes, hacia las comunidades LGTBIQ y hacia las mujeres que están a través, ¿no? Que enfrentan diversas partes del problema, no necesariamente los efectos por el consumo específicamente de las sustancias. Así que me parece que ese sería, además del financiamiento, la posibilidad de financiar programas basados en la educación entre pares, creo que algo de eso ponían recién en el chat, ¿no? Financiar otro tipo de programas que faciliten el acercamiento, y sobre todo que programas que dialoguen con otros campos de la salud, ¿no? Las estrategias de reducción de daños no se limitan al acceso al tratamiento por consumo, sino información, acceso a tratamiento a personas que viven con VIH, otras infecciones de transmisión sexual, tuberculosis, ¿no? Múltiples afecciones vinculadas con la salud, que si se asiste en y se brinda información en un primer nivel, en un primer umbral, reduce nada más los costos de asistencia a nivel de intervenciones mucho más complejas. Así que nosotros invitamos a pensar que sin despenalización no hay acceso a la salud integral ni a la salud mental.
Thank you so much, and thank you for being so clear. Thanks, Jorgelina. Ed, what would be your main request to the authorities from the treatment field?
So my first three would be money, money, money. I think that we need funding to help to sort of drive and to push the things that, and money sends to drive everything. So I think from the authorities, what they need to do is to be able to put money that focuses specifically on gender-related treatment and treatment services, and also money that can help to be more inclusive around treatment for women, and then also for people from the LGBTQ community. I think that becomes a really important component. I also think that there needs to be things that should be culturally sensitive to culture, various cultures in different parts of the world. So as the governments are developing, maybe not necessarily just taking something, for example, like from seeking safety curriculum, but also making sure that it's being tailored specifically for the culture that it is being implemented. I think that funding, along with policy changes that focus on making sure that things are much more inclusive overall, is a key element that could help to make some changes. So I think the big thing would be money. And I think that I think money and funding helps to drive things and push things in the direction that it needs to go.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Very important component for sure. And Jane, what could the authorities do for making your work easier? What is it for you?
As Edward said, funding. I think funding is coming up across the board so as to make the treatment more affordable for the women. Clear policies whereby both LGBT and women, taken care of. Also, coming up with activities whereby the women can get funded to be economically empowered, because sometimes you find lack of economic empowerment sometimes will lead women into, substance use because they are not able to fend for themselves. So I think that would really help. And also having, training community health workers from a government perspective, where they can go much more interior into the communities and be able, to educate the women and more so the community on the aspect of, substance use. And hand in hand, they can work with the women from those communities. And also for the younger people, because you find once the women are affected, definitely our children are affected. So that support program, in as much as we're doing the support program for the women, how do we engage the children so that also they don't get caught up in the mix of when the parent maybe is going through treatment. Also safe houses where you can retreat instead of when you feel things are going down the drain and maybe there's nobody to look up to, you have a safe house where you can walk to and be able to reinvent yourself again. So I think for me, if the government could come up with safe houses where people can be able to come in, and then the funding to ensure that the program is well run, I think that would go a great deal.
Great, thanks. And thank you so much for pointing out on the support system for children, which is indeed very important. So with that, we would have closed our side of the roundtable. Now we have many, many questions coming from the public, from Slido and the chat. I'll do my best to try to pose them in an organized way. And as there are so many questions, I will not be able maybe to pose all the questions posed by the same person. So we'll pick some of them. So here we go. Questions from Slido. Question to the whole panel. What concrete policies are missing for you to be able to reach the necessary results? And then there is a second question also from this person to know if you're also working with drug user networks in developing your programs. So who would like to start? Dan?
Me? Yeah.
If you want. Or I mean, this is to the whole panel. If you feel like you would like to answer, if not... there are many questions, so do you want me to pose it again?
No, I'll take it. I'll take the question. The second half of what you said, drug user networks. Yeah, that's very important. I think as an organization and as our policy, we also have it laid out that we don't create anything without people who are really the beneficiaries or the stakeholders or the people who are the victims, or so we do have a clear rules that we engage with the population that really has gone the full cycle and sort of also trying to regain their life back. So that's important for us at our organization too. What policies actually will facilitate or help this whole process? I think we have all policies very well laid out, all in rhetoric, the challenges, the last mile or the last, you know, mile implementation of these policies. It really does not translate into actual, you know, programs or benefits for women. So as far as CEDAW is concerned, we are signatories to it. As far as Child Rights Convention is concerned, we're all signatories to it. It's pretty well laid out in our framework of policies, but one, people don't understand it. They're not sensitized about it. They don't know the policy procedures and how to sort of translate that into the programs that they create. So the challenge is that we don't have enough people who are sensitized or are kind of taken through the full cycle of the benefits of going through the policy framework and having that included in the programs.
Thank you. Thank you, Jorgelina.
Yo diría que no hay programa de reducción de daños, sino se parte del trabajo cotidiano con las personas que usan drogas. Eso es parte, digo, la pregunta sobre el trabajo con los usuarios, más allá de que además participamos y promovemos activamente las redes de usuarios, tanto a nivel de la región como a nivel local, pero las personas que usan drogas son parte central de los dispositivos. Incluso se transforman, ¿no?, en promotores de salud, en reductores de daños, se incorporan en los equipos. Esto pasa en toda la región y en el mundo, porque es parte, ¿no?, de pensar, porque justamente se reconoce a la persona que usa drogas con un saber sobre sus propios padecimientos, sobre sus propios malestares, pero también sobre el tipo de respuestas posibles a construir para abordar esos problemas, ¿no? Y nuestros programas se desarrollan con usuarios, tanto el que se trabaja, ¿no?, en contextos de consumos recreativos, como en el trabajo con adolescentes y jóvenes en contextos de vulnerabilidad. Pero hace 20 años, cuando en Argentina y en la región había más usuarios de drogas inyectables, eran las propias personas y mujeres, ¿no?, usuarias de drogas inyectables las que eran parte de los programas. Pero además, en el diseño de los materiales, si no incluimos las voces y los modos en que expresan, ¿no?, y dicen y narran sus propios malestares y padecimientos, la respuesta preventiva o de acceso o de acercamiento no funciona. Entonces, para nosotros es fundamental el trabajo, ¿no?, el aprender con los usuarios, ¿no?, una ecología de saberes y una interdisciplina no solo de profesionales, sino de las experiencias vitales de aquellos que están atravesando ciertas cuestiones. Y en términos de qué políticas son necesarias, por lo menos desde la perspectiva de la región, son necesarias políticas de vivienda, de salud, de trabajo, ¿no?, en el sentido de los derechos sociales, económicos, políticos y culturales, porque partimos de pensar que los problemas vinculados con el uso de drogas son problemas de derechos humanos, ¿no?, de acceso a ¿no?, bienes, servicios y derechos que la mayoría de las poblaciones no acceden.
Thank you so much. Ed, do you want to answer in this?
Yeah, I just would really like to echo what Diana and Orlina had said. I think that it's I think that really sort of the emphasis and focus on policy and policy implementation. Sometimes you get the policies in place, but then nobody follows through with them. I think that making sure that they're sort of clear and enforced, specifically within the treatment community, so that way they can be more. And then I also go back to, I think they need to put money behind it that helps to focus on the implementation piece of it.
Great, thanks. Jane?
Okay, same, come up with policies. Mostly you find very nice policies put on paper, but when you come to the ground, they're not actually adhered to. And also there's a lot of, sometimes you find the police will act against the, you know, women. Maybe if you come across the police and you're high, they will not need to understand. So, you know, decriminalizing the, you know, the aspect of substance use, people who are using, you know, abusing drugs, not to make it like it's a criminal offense, just to understand this person is going through other issues and need, you know, help. When they're arrested, it's not to take them to, you know, the police cell, at least seek treatment for them, because sometimes you find there's there's an intertwine of crime and substance use both ways, whether it is male, even for women, because sometimes when they are not getting their fill and they don't have money, you can go and commit crime. How do we now, you know, from a government perspective and from a policy perspective, how do we separate the two to know that actually this is not a criminal, but the person is going through, you know, substance use and needs help? So that is one of the areas we have been following. I know we are having, we are reviewing our Mental Health Act, and that is something which is coming up, and we're really trying to work on that, because sincerely speaking, you're arresting somebody even who does not know his state or her state, but because the person is intoxicated, is taken to a police cell instead of seeking help. So I think those are some of the policies really would like, you know, looked at and amendments made to help the women per se.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Then there was a comment in the chat from Lena Harake saying that women's age has to be considered when planning treatment programs. Even elderly women have addictions and have equal rights for good health. So maybe here ask to the panel or who would like to respond on how to tackle drug user aging population from a gender approach. Do you have any thoughts on this? Whatever, whoever wants to jump, just.
I would just throw in, I think that it's really important because it is sort of interesting as I've watched the field over the years, as our population is getting older, having more specific in relation to not only gender, but age. In a lot of ways, your approach to a 55-year-old male could be very different than a 20-year-old male. Same way with women, or people from the LGBTQ community. I think that being sensitive to age issues are important, but I think you can also sometimes use that as a little bit of an advantage within certain groups. So if you're doing a women's group and you have some elder women in the group, it can also be helpful for getting the perspective of somebody who's had the life experience. So there's ways of kind of filtering and using that life experience to help with some of the younger. And they can also be help with mentoring a lot of people in treatment and treatment services. But I do think it has to be something that you have to be conscious and aware of, and that you should be able to sort of add pieces to your treatment track to help deal with it.
Great, thanks, Ed. Does anybody else want to react on this question?
Yes, I'd like to flip the other side, Ed, in terms of what we see as a general social normalization of the use of drugs, alcohol, tobacco, being pushed by the industry. If we look at the age brackets, they don't play with teenagers or young adults in promoting products, but there is a clear promotional effort that normalizes the use of, especially tobacco, alcohol, the alcohol industry, as women age or working, the affordability of women when they work. And specifically in a country like mine, that is very well targeted. It's kind of product placed in all our movies and advertisements. And, you know, so there is a serious push to by the industry to socially normalize this kind of, you know, women spending on alcohol substance, and that then puts pressure on us also working towards giving care for the elderly as they age. That's not there in the systemic program as of now. So we need to do something to even go to the other side and speak about, you know, there is this whole population of women that is a spending population. They have the power to spend. And there's a very targeted effort by the industry to, you know, hook them on, and not early, but into the aging population. And I'm just wanting to bring that as a very strong point, because that's something we kind of overlook or we oversee. While we ask for treatment and care for the aging population, we don't realize that there's a huge industry that's normalizing social behavior in terms of hooking onto addiction substances, habits of dependency. So just wanted to give another perspective. Yeah.
Great, thank you for adding on this. Does anybody else want to react on this, or shall I move to the next question? Okay. From Slido, there is a question saying, from prevention to treatment, how can providers make their services more family-centered? And what is a good first step? Any thoughts? Does anybody want to talk? Jane? Yes, go ahead.
I think that's a very good question because sometimes when you're doing treatment and you avoid the family, you find sometimes the issue actually is not addressed at the family level. You're not helping this person much. So I think as the person is taking a treatment, the individual is going through the treatment, it's always important also for the family members to come in and you have session with the family just to address the whole issue holistically. Because sometimes you find there's something which is driving, there's an underlined issue which is driving this person to abuse. Whether it's a lady, maybe their family matters, maybe there's the aspect of gender-based violence within the family and the person is not speaking. So when you involve the family, we always say it is when you have a person who is abusing, the whole family is affected. It's not just the individual. So they also need to go through the process of treatment so that during the integration period, the person going back home is going in an environment which is more friendly. Because if the environment is still the same old environment, which was driving the person into abusing or to using, definitely going back there will still take the person back. So the family is very, very important at the time of admission for them also to agree that they would have to go through the process with the individual is going through treatment. So it will, like what I'm seeing currently, what we are doing, we've come up with a family program. We have an association for people who are running treatment centers and rehabilitation centers. And what we have done, every Saturday, we have come up with a program whereby families are able to log in, we are able to share the information, and they are taken through the processes, through the stages of addiction, what they need to do as a family, the acceptance, because you find sometimes the person is bashed so much, you know, straight from a treatment or a rehabilitation center, the family expects now you're okay, everything is okay, you run on well, you go back to work, and you find this person is still very, very vulnerable. So that program I've seen, it's really, there are so many families who are coming up and they're able to share and they're saying they're understanding, at least now they understand you know, what the other person is going through. And we have had a very good, when we started, we were not very many, but currently I'm seeing the group is, the numbers are going up. And I think it's a very, very good support system for the individual. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And here I would like to add a short publicity message, because actually from Dianova, we're currently conducting a survey for assessing the rights of the children, if they're taking or not into treatment. So we'll put the link in the chat in case you're interested on that and you wanna support us in this work. So coming back to the family center question, does anybody else wanna add?
I just want to add that I think, I'm sorry, go ahead. Did you want to, were you going to go?
No, go ahead. After you.
So I was just going to add, I think that families connected, you know, working with families in treatment are essential. And I think in terms of even the individual that comes in, connecting with their family, reconnecting with their family is an essential part of helping with the treatment process. And we try to do that at Odyssey House, but a lot of families are very angry with their family member who has been utilizing and abusing substances almost to the point where they've had to sort of wipe their hands of them, and trying to get them to reconnect it, we try very, very hard with. Also, excitingly enough, there is some new funding coming down here in the United States to specifically treat families. So you could treat a whole family unit and a whole family could go into residential care for up to a year, which would be just actually amazing. So people wouldn't have to be separated, or men and women wouldn't have to be separated, or the children wouldn't have to be separated from the parents, that they could all be in treatment together. And you could focus on a lot of different things, from the family reunification, maintaining the family unit, as well as helping everybody transition out together into the community family-wise. So I just wanted to add that. Thank you.
Thanks. Diana, you want to go?
I just also wanted to bring the perspective of the child in treatment. That's a very complex situation because the law of the land, according to Child Rights Protection Policy, demands for a full-time caretaker to be with the child through the treatment program, which many of the families cannot afford because the parents have to go to work, they have to fend for the home, and there is no support system for the child to go through a full-fledged program, because there is a law in place that demands for a caretaker in the process. So in situations like that, the government really needs to either create a robust system of care protection within a treatment center where the caretaker need not be around, or they have the facilities to take care of the patient, while we also need the community to understand that there are families that need support while the child goes into program and pitch in as buddy programs or buddies who can pitch in with the family to support. So this dimension of children going into treatment and families not able to provide for treatment or stay throughout the treatment as caretakers is an angle that I think many of us in the Asian nations face. So, and it's so complex that as the numbers increase, our systemic support fails. Funding or any kind of money is not going to solve it. It definitely has to come from a prevention process, because early on, children getting hooked is a longer cycle of the addiction and care. So children in substance abuse and care programs is a huge, I don't know, we're not able to get our head around it in terms of care facilities. I just wanted to bring that perspective.
Thank you. It certainly needs attention, and hopefully we'll be also working on this. Jorgelina.
No, quería reforzar algo, me parece muy importante lo que dijo Diana, que no es solamente la inclusión de las familias, sino de las comunidades, justamente porque, digo, vuelven, las personas siguen viviendo en esas comunidades, en esos grupos, siguen en su vida cotidiana, y las prácticas de discriminación o de rechazo, incluso cuando no una familia está atravesando una situación vinculada con los consumos, son de mucho padecimiento para esas familias, para esas mujeres, entonces es muy importante la inclusión de la comunidad, ¿no? La respuesta comunitaria, que no es solamente el tratamiento en la comunidad, y también lo pienso desde nuestra experiencia de trabajo con adolescentes y con jóvenes, distinguir cuándo es necesario incluir a esa familia, porque muchas veces la familia, como también decía Ed, es parte del problema, entonces también registramos que hay una compulsión a la inclusión de lo familiar como parte de la estrategia de abordaje, y muchas veces parte de nuestra tarea es distinguir que esa familia, más que ser parte de la solución, es parte del problema.
Thanks, Pauline. Great, thank you, Jorgelina. So another question comes from South Africa. Hi there, Marvin from South Africa. What happens when the government or legislators seemingly ignore the outcry of the LGBTQ's outcry? Just past week, we saw a lady get murdered and dismembered. I won't even talk about rape. Certain communities practice what they term correctional rape. There's an enormous need for education awareness across the board. Do you have any comment on this? Would you like to react? This looks more like a comment, but in case you want to go into this topic.
Well, I would just say that it's a horrible endeavor that if, especially if the government's ignoring the issue. The hard part would be just really around, it takes a lot of grassroots advocacy to sort of educate the elected officials to be able to focus on issues. That's definitely a long haul in terms of trying to get the awareness associated with it. I know the LGBTQ community suffers in a lot of different nations across the world because of religious or stigma associated with their individual preferences. It's very sad when you see that. But the only thing that I think you can do are the things that are associated with trying to educate and working with the elected officials to try to hopefully help to change their perspectives on it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Any other reaction? No? Okay. Yeah, Diana. You're on mute, Diana.
Yeah. What we've seen sort of work within the LGBT community is their peer support. It sort of is one of the biggest strength areas that they are available for each other, like the women available for women, the community standing up to be of support, bring people in who need help, people who really need to, you know, go through the cycle of care. So it is difficult. It is, at least for in the country that I come from, it's a very unaddressed. We don't address that area very seriously when we talk about substance abuse and drugs. But I think the community is doing its job. But they are coming together and they're bringing out their issues and sort of putting it on the table, and that's sort of helping them come out and seek support. So just wanted to say.
Thank you so much. So we have another very interesting question coming from Asociación Proyecto Hombre, saying that what strategies do you recommend for care organizations to work with men who use drugs from a gender perspective? Who would like to answer this one?
What? I just want to add that I think from our perspective, from Odyssey House's perspective, when we have gender-specific group, we break off the men and women. And we also do a lot of education in the men's groups, specifically about women's and women's issues, so that way they can get a different perspective and understanding. Also, because we have a lot of people from the LGBTQ community in our treatment programs, we do a lot of cross-education about that to try to help to reduce stigma and normalize more and more of the process. But we do a lot of focus on gender-specific treatment and services for men and women, and then also people from the LGBTQ community. So I do think it's important because I think also men have specific issues, which I think, you know, you can help them to deal with oftentimes in a male group. But I think there's been much more focus on that already too, but there needs to be more development on the side for women and the LGBTQ community, so.
Thanks so much, Ed. Really important point. Anybody else? No? Okay, let's, Angelina? Yeah.
Me parece que no es solamente el enfoque en el tratamiento, digamos, pensando en los patrones específicos de consumo de los varones o de las masculinidades que usan drogas, sino también la posibilidad de generar espacios entre pares, digamos. Hay, por lo menos en Argentina, este producto del movimiento feminista, se fueron generando múltiples espacios entre varones para deconstruir y desarmar esas miradas estereotipadas sobre los géneros. Incluso la posibilidad de expresar sus propios sentimientos y emociones. Me parece que el patriarcado también ha impactado en las posibilidades de los varones a poder expresar de qué modo sufren, padecen, ¿no? Y sobre todo con los consumos asociados a ciertos rituales de masculinidad hegemónica, ¿no? Ser más proveedor o ser mejor o ser visto socialmente como algo valorado cuando se consume, cuando se asocia con cuestiones de masculinidades más hegemónicas. Entonces, por lo menos desde la perspectiva de reducción de riesgos de daños, también insistimos en promover espacios de diálogo entre varones sobre otros aspectos de su vida cotidiana, no necesariamente con la centralidad en el uso de drogas, porque el uso de drogas es algo más que le pasa a las personas entre otro conjunto de padecimientos y de situaciones en su vida cotidiana. Y también promover la posibilidad de encuentro, ¿no? Digo, me parece que es necesario espacios entre géneros, desde la propia identidad genérica hasta generar espacios de encuentro en las diferencias, porque el problema se da en la tolerancia entre las diferencias, no solo entre varones y mujeres, entre quienes usan drogas y quienes no usan, sino en todo aquello que es diferente a los modelos que consideramos valorados en nuestra vida cotidiana.
Thanks. So there is another question from Philip from Liberia. How do I get help as an organization that will help enable state organization to carry out awareness, sensibilization of the risk and dangers of drugs and substance abuse, and also to train people who will carry on awareness, sensitization and education? Wait, I think I have it twice. Let me read it again, sorry. And also help women and children to prevent drug use and substance abuse. Sorry, let me say it again. How to prevent drug abuse and addiction? How do I get help from this normal body to enable me carry on awareness and advocacy of the risk and danger of drugs in my country, and also to help women and children to prevent drugs and substance abuse? Sorry for that. It's on the chat box. Any reactions?
Well, I think the first thing is, and I spend a lot of time, and Odyssey and a lot of our staff spend a lot of time, is just advocacy. You have to advocate on your towards your government and your elected officials and educate them. And that sometimes takes time and years for constant process of sort of educating and working with them and re-following up so you can start to push and change policy and work. That would be my recommendation.
Since the question is also a little prevention specific, I'd like to throw in a couple of points. If you're working with communities, I think there is great merit in involving the community to safeguard spaces, at least where children are at schools or playgrounds and common socializing spaces. So we've seen that the community members, when they get involved, they're sensitized, sort of become like the first line of defense to protect their young, the children in their schools and their playgrounds. So community intervention is one of those large scale prevention methodologies or tools that has proved to be very effective when it comes to a prevention process. So working on a very specific community engagement program does help in long-term prevention activities.
Thank you. And also referring to one of the comments, I would like to ask you on what can be done for ensuring evidence-based interventions. What do you think?
Specific to women or?
No, specific to prevention, to treatment, like in general.
Yeah. Right. There are a lot of best practice programs around the world that are, as of now, established as very evidence-based programs for intervention, especially when it comes to youth programs, when it comes to peer-led intervention programs. So evidence-based programs are right now very much very available. The challenges, like Ed said earlier, we need to contextualize it to our cultural, socioeconomic perspectives. That's where we lack our strength, because there are programs that has been successful in a particular set or in a particular community. But if I were to speak of a country like mine, we work with limited resources in a limited resources setting. How can these models be effective? And that's where the evidence is lacking. There are evidence-based programs. They are successful programs in at least the prevention space. But the challenge is, how can we translate that or customize it or bring it into a cultural context into very limited resource settings? All of us are speaking about lack of funds, the problem of no funds to do our work. And no support from the government. In that kind of a limited resource setting, how are we going to actually, you know, tailor make it to our needs, our community? So that's where the evidence lacks. And if you were to ask, what can we do? I think all of us as civil societies, wherever we work, we need to bring in a discipline of actually mapping all our data, keeping our documentation of all our activities. Because someday, I suppose it will lead to some kind of a process which will document change. So I think as small as we are in the different pockets that we function, we need a discipline of mapping our data, keeping our records of activities, which shows over time some kind of a trend analysis which will lead to evidence based interventions.
Thanks, Naya. Thank you very much. Jane?
Yes, also coming up with programs whereby we engage the youth on activities. I think in the last CND conference, there's something which came out very well with people from Qatar, the program they're doing with UNODC on engaging the youth on the football aspect. So maybe from a community perspective, we could come up with programs whereby we engage the youth and also where we correcting data to see, you know, from time to time, you do the mapping, getting, you know, when you do that, you'll be able to come up with proper evidence-based programs where you engage them and you see whether that you're reducing, where is the reduction, where the gaps are, and, you know, we'll be able now to have a proper information, because largely what I've seen is we lack a lot of data on substance use, more so, I would say, maybe in the third world countries, and I would say maybe in Kenya, what we don't have properly is proper data to say, this is where we are, this is where, you know, the level we are, what we apply. But I think with better programs, with good funding and keeping documentation, collecting data, which is a drug of choice, because it's not all drugs which are abused. You try to see what is this, more so like the youth, which drug is being abused a lot, and the numbers that will be able to really assist and do a more evidence-based. More so we move from the old tradition of treatment, because I believe in some places we're still using the old tradition of treatment, and come up with more scientific evidence-based models of treatment that will be able to really, you know, be more professional and bring out more evidence-based programs. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much. So now there are more questions, but we won't have time to go through all of them. But there is one thing that I really want the panelists to do, and it's actually is that we would like to ask you, what are you the key takeaways you would like people attending this this roundtable to have from your contribution? Like, what have been the key learnings of this year's that you would like to transmit to the attendants? And for that, I would like to give you 2 minutes. So big challenge to wrap everything up in 2 minutes. But if you agree, we can go for it. Diane, would you like to start?
Oh, yes. first of all, I think it was a very interactive a discussion today. It was so interesting and well-fielded, well-organized. The key takeaways, if people are really listening, I think for us as a team or people who work in this space, we need to really stay together. We really need to share our stories. We need to bring out into the open all our tried and tested methods so that whatever we do, I think it contributes to the greater perspective of keeping our kids safe, women accessible to care, and letting them know their rights. So I think there is more need for sharing stories, sharing experiences, sharing best practices, and more platforms where all of us can come together and I think sort of stand beside each other in our work. That's one thing that I'm clearly taking away, because just listening to the panelists has been very encouraging. I think the second one would be that as far as women's rights are concerned, women's issues are concerned, I think all vulnerable sections, LGBTQ, people with disabilities, all the vulnerable segments need to be addressed in all our discussions. It's just not women, it's not just children, it's not LGBTQ, but all vulnerable segments of society need to be part of our discussions at policy, at treatment, or any kind of framework that we're having. We need to have a little space or a prime space for discussing vulnerable groups and their issues. That's it.
Thank you, and really on time. Jorgelina, do you want to go next, Jorgelina?
Bueno, Primero, también agradecer el espacio, la escucha respetuosa, las diferencias incluso, y la posibilidad de enriquecimiento. Me parece que eso sería el primer aprendizaje, ¿no?, en términos de generar programas o propuestas respetuosas de los derechos y de las diversidades. Pero me quedaría con cuatro, voy a tratar de ser sintética. Lo primero sería transversalizar el problema, pensar en los problemas vinculados con los usos de drogas. No es solamente un problema de las sustancias ni de las personas que usan drogas, sino que es un problema de derechos humanos. Me parece que eso quedó bastante claro, por lo menos para nosotros, desde, ¿no?, estos programas, estas perspectivas, lo pensamos así. La segunda es que no hay respuestas únicas. Entonces, frente a una diversidad de patrones de consumo y de problemas en los que se expresan las afectaciones vinculadas con los usos de drogas, tanto en lo físico como en lo legal, como en lo psicológico, nos requiere pensar en una diversidad de respuestas y en los modos en que esas respuestas se implementan de modo local según la identidad y la idiosincrasia de las comunidades y de los grupos con los cuales estamos trabajando. Y el tercero tiene que ver con, bueno, la centralidad de la participación. Para nosotros, y desde la perspectiva de reducción de riesgos y daños, la inclusión activa de las personas que usan drogas, no solo en la gestión de sus padecimientos, sino en la gestión de una vida más digna y del acceso a, ¿no?, a derechos y a respeto por esas diversidades. Entonces, promover, como también decía Diana, la organización, la participación activa, ¿no?, incluir activamente esas voces de juventudes, de adolescentes, de mujeres, de comunidades LGTBI, para pensar los problemas y las respuestas de modo más situado. Y finalmente, como es un problema de derechos humanos, si no despenalizamos todos aquellos comportamientos, no solo vinculados con los usos de drogas, sino con las elecciones de género que en el mundo están siendo un problema, sin despenalizar esos comportamientos que se consideran riesgosos y peligrosos, no vamos a poder construir, ¿no?, un mundo más justo y más digno.
Perfect. Very clear and right on time. Thank you so much, Jocelina. Ed?
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank everybody. I really appreciate it. I also want to do a shout out for my staff that got up early this morning to listen to me. I do appreciate that. The thing that I think is important, I think, is very much so as part of a takeaway, and I really appreciate all the information from the other presenters. But I think the thing is if you're not doing anything, start doing something around gender-specific treatment and also people with the LGBTQ community. I'm a firm believer that if you build it, people will start to come and come and get involved in providing the services associated with it. I think the other thing I think that's super important, I think, is if you are doing something, work on improving it. Look at how you can improve, listen to your clients, listen to the services and the things that are being done, and focus on that. And then the other thing is, I think it's very important, is advocacy. You got to advocate and work with people in your government. You have to educate them about the issue. And you will find people that will think the same way you do. You just have to sort of keep going through them and working with them till you find people who can champion your cause to focus on providing these kinds of services. And I think they're very important. They're very important to Odyssey House. And they're very important to all the people here on the call. But advocacy is about educating and getting our elected officials, as well as other treatment programs and other people involved, and so giving the kind of support to these services. Thank you all so much for your time.
Amazing. Thanks. Jane?
Thank you. First is to just to thank the organizers and the panelists and all the guests in this webinar today. I think it was a learning point for us. One of my take homes is I've realized all the four panelists were discussing on the same issue. And we had one thing in common. There's the funding, there's the treatment, there's the, you know, the respect of human dignity. How do we treat anybody who is coming up for treatment? I think this was very a great point for me. Two, I would want to have more of this kind of webinars to just learn from each other. And it's a global problem. It's not just one country based. It's just a global problem. And how do we do more of, you know, advocating, working with the government? Because as CSOs or as human rights activists who are trying to advocate for proper treatment, if we do not engage the government, we won't do much. And I like what Edward said. I think in the United States, you're lucky, you are way ahead. The government is doing a bit of funding. We'll try to do the same back in our countries and see how we work together. Once again, I want to thank you, all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane, and thank all the panelists for this very interesting roundtable. Now that we have fresh this takeaways, we would like to ask to turn again to Slido and ask you one final question. This was truly an interactive webinar, so let's go for it. And it is to know if this webinar has inspired you to take action in your respective services to promote gender perspectives. And if so, if you can summarize somehow in which aspects, that would be amazing. So I'll leave a couple of minutes to connect again. Other answers coming. Promoting family-centered services, learning from other, adapting our services. Well, there's so many. It's moving quick, it's moving fast. Necessity of training staff. Wonderful to hear international perspective. Girls, young women, and women's human rights must continue to be highlighted. Yes, in the perspective of speaking out against gender violence and stigmatization. Advocacy to change decision makers' mind, human rights, crucial issue, very enlightening. So all in all, I think those would be some of my concluding remarks. I would really like to thank all of you for being with us today. It was very enriching for myself. I will now like to give the floor to Regina for closing the event. Thank you, bye.
Thank you, Lucia. And thank you so much to all of our brilliant speakers for sharing your expertise. To Lucia, of course, for brilliant moderation, to our fantastic interpreter who has been working hard these past 2 hours, to our colleagues as well behind the scenes, Cressida, Mario, and Gisella, and of course to the participants who have spent your morning or day or afternoon and night with us today and for enriching us with your questions and comments. It's been truly a valuable webinar where we've heard varying perspectives, varying from varying regions, and I'm sure that we have all had something or a lot of things to take away from this event. So after this, we will send you all a thank you email, and it will include some useful links, some additional questions. If you'd like to have them answered, you can email them to us. And then you'll be able to see the video in both Spanish and English afterwards on our website. So on behalf of WFAD and Dianova, we thank you all so very much for taking the time today. And we hope to see you all in the future at upcoming events. Thank you so much.